Good evening, I'd like to call the regular school committee meeting to order, today being November 16th, 2016. The meeting today is being recorded by the Peabody School Committee's recording secretary, Leanna Harris. The matters listed below on our agenda are those reasonably anticipated by the chair, which may be discussed after meeting. Not all items listed may in fact be discussed, and other items not listed may also be brought up for discussion to the extent permitted by law. I'd like to first start with a moment of silence, and then we're going to go to the Pledge of Allegiance. And if everybody could please stand for a moment of silence. And if everybody could please keep in their thoughts, the city of Peabody suffered a tragic loss last week with the passing of Ella O'Donnell, and a true angel that inspired so many people in this city, touched so many lives across our community. And I ask to keep her in your thoughts, prayers, her family, Dennis, Aaron, and Sydney, and all those that loved her and that family. Thank you. And now I'm going to turn over to Dr. Levine. We have some special students today from the Carroll School that are going to be introduced to help us with our Pledge of Allegiance. Dr. Levine?
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. We have two terrific students from our Carroll School, and I'd like to welcome them. Amelia Stewart. Amelia is a fourth grader in Ms. Tatton's class at the Carroll School. Amelia is an avid dancer and takes ballet, tap, jazz, modern, and hip-hop. I'm a hip-hopper myself. At the Mass Motion Dance Studio. She will be competing in a dance competition in Disney World this February. Wow. And Amelia also loves to cook with her mom. Welcome, Amelia. Amelia, step forward. Libby David is also a fourth grader. She is in Ms. McAllister's class. Her hobbies include cheerleading, softball, playing outside with her friends, and watching movies. Lily has two dogs, Henry and Savannah, and loves to spend time with her family. Her favorite subjects are science and social studies. Welcome, Lily. Now, young ladies, would lead us, please, in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Great job. I'd also like to introduce Tracy Smith, the principal of the Carroll School.
And now Dr. Levine is going to do some hip-hop for us.
if we only had the music.
Okay, there's no objection. We have a number of representatives from the South School, families, and principals, assistant principals, and teachers that are here today for a very special reason. Thank you. And if there's no objection, I'd like to go out of order and go to the South School. That's agreeable. All in favor? Thank you.
Okay, I have been in contact with Monique Nappy, the principal of the South School, who has been working with her PTO and a number of parents who have a lot of energy moving that energy actually toward a project that she is going to describe. And I would invite Monique up to the microphone to describe to the audience what it is that you propose to do.
I think I can be loud enough if you're...
Great. Use your principal's voice.
Yes, the kind one. So thank you, Mayor, for allowing me to go on first, and the school committee. It's nice to be back. Thank you, Herb, Dr. Levine, and Ms. Merchak, for your time. I have great pleasure being at the South Memorial. I find it an endearing community with a lot of empathy and love. We have had that loss this past week, but they've endured it far longer than I. And we, when I first came on board, I noticed their playground was just a little tot lot. And I believe in playgrounds, as you know, from my past history. So I made the slight suggestion to Melissa LeBlanc, Trackie over there, the PTO chairperson, that, you know, is there a want for a playground? And she said, oh boy, is there ever. But then it became bitter because we really thought that this would be a nice way to put all of our energies and love. We would like to build this this year and fund it so that we can dedicate it to Ella J. O'Donnell Playground. Well, the full title will be Ella J. O'Donnell South Memorial School Playground. And I did speak to the parents, and they would be honored with that for the memory of their daughter. And they were grateful and thankful that the city would consider that. So I thank you for allowing us to do this project. We have great support. We have support from the ward counselors as well, and of all the playground committee that are present today.
So thank you very much, Monique, through the mayor. So what I would ask for from the school committee would be a vote to allow the South School principal and South School community to begin to move forward, to build the playground, to do the fundraising. And I would suggest that we be kept up to date regularly as to how the progress is going. I would ask the school committee to consider that.
Mrs. Dunn?
Motion to follow recommendation of the superintendent.
Second.
Okay, you've heard the motion made by Mrs. Dunn, seconded by Mr. Rosignol. Why don't we take a roll call vote, please? Oh, on the motion, Mrs. Dunn?
Just one piece of information or question. I noticed, you know, I know it's a rough draft.
Yeah.
But is this something Mr. Healy can help with? Because he really should, because this might be the chance to help you folks with the whole traffic configuration and everything
in
the back. Yeah.
It is definitely just draft for the proposal. Mm-hmm. Nothing has been designed because I do have three bids to look at the property. And also, Mr. Healy, I know I've been out of commission for a little bit, so I have not been able to contact him. But he will be, and he's going to advise us as far as the old tot lot as well. And then we want to make certain that we have enough ample room for not only the playground, but also for open space for students who want to play ball, basketball, football, and throw the football, and also jump rope and other activities. So we're not limiting ourselves just to the full area, and that's why that was just a rough draft that I drew for the proposal.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Will not be, and thank you all for being here today. I'm a South School boy, and we need a new playground, and to be able to dedicate it in Ella's name, I think, is just a wonderful gesture. And I'm glad Councilor Turco, he's been a strong advocate for the South School, and I know for this project, he's talked to a number of us about it, and I think all of us want to be on board and help out. One thing I can pledge, and I know Councilor Turco will join me, is, I believe actually he's on the committee, about the Community Preservation Fund. There's been a number of projects, parks, that we've been able to assist at the end in making those projects a reality. Thankfully, the law changed a couple of years ago that allowed us to use community preservation funds to do new, to build new parks or to expand parks or to improve parks. Up until about 3 years ago, we couldn't use it for that purpose, but now we can. And I know we've assisted in a number of parks, including over at the Wells School, which has a beautiful playground now. And to have it in Ella's name, I think, will be terrific. Typically, the Community Preservation Committee likes to be the last one in.
Yes.
So I think as you move forward with your fundraising efforts, once you figure out what the cost is going to be, perhaps I can sit down with you, Councilor Turco, the members of the school committee certainly, and we can work on a budget, and I can kind of give you my thoughts as to the appropriate amount to ask community preservation. But certainly they'll be willing to step up, I think, with a considerable amount of money to finish the project. They don't want to be the first group in.
Sure.
They want to be, after some work is done and some money's raised, they would like to be able to come in and finish the project. And I'll be happy and actually honored to assist you in walking through that process and advocating and speaking at the meeting for it. With, I'm sure, Councilor Turco. Johnny, are you on the committee still?
Yeah.
Yep. and I know John will speak very passionately for that as well. So please keep that in mind. Once you kind of have some numbers and maybe a little bit of time, some time frames, you know, perhaps we can have a meeting where I can come over to the South School and sit and give you my thoughts on the next steps. Mr. Rosenthal?
Yeah, just one question. Are you looking at this to be a community-type build?
Yes, absolutely, like we did for Welch.
Yep, and at the Burke as well. So excellent.
Yeah, and the community is very strong, so I know we'll have a lot of support, and I'll tap into other schools as well.
Perfect. Thank you.
Mrs. Cochran?
Thank you. Just wanted to say thank you to everyone that came out tonight and that is helping in this effort. It's a wonderful, wonderful thought, and I couldn't be more behind it. Something you did just mention is the Burke.
Yes.
We did go through a similar playground situation, and there are still some people that are there that would be more than happy to help out with the ways that we funded it. There's some names that I can give you afterwards.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was a community build, and we were out there putting that playground together, and it was wonderful. And I just want to thank you.
They actually helped us at the Welch, too.
Yeah. Yes, it was wonderful. Yeah. So I just want to thank everyone who's doing this, and you definitely have my support. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for being here.
We need a roll call.
We do need a roll call. Roll call.
Mr. Hawkins?
Yes.
Mr. Rosenthal?
Yes.
Mrs. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Olympio?
Yes.
Mr. Miko?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor, I vote for a merry-go-round for that South School playground.
Put your face on each one.
Yes.
Let's talk about that before we make any decisions on that.
I was thinking of dartboard myself.
But this is not for thank you, Ms. Costa. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Councilor Turco, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next item on the agenda, we're going to turn over to Dr. Levine. We have Mr. Hyatt here for the science department.
Thank you. The school committee has asked that the science program at the high school and the middle school that have been adopted be presented to the school committee so that they have an understanding of why we chose what we chose. And I invite George Hyatt and Mrs. Cirillo. George is our department head of science at the high school. And Mrs. Cirillo, I don't know you, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, should I introduce that? Mrs. Cirillo, she teaches biology at the high school as well.
Hi. Good, how are you?
We were asked to come and meet with you because we have one of the greatest, I think, learning packages. A wonderful gift, actually, has been given to us. It was the adoption of a new learning program, actually. It's not so much a textbook. It really is a learning program. And we need to inform you in terms of how that was chosen, in terms of the process that took place. So this began actually over 2 years ago. And Ms. Rula is here with me because she probably has the most continuity in terms of being involved in all the meetings that took place. So we're kind of arguing over the time. I believe it was the 2014-15 school year we actually had a textbook committee that was put together, and a number of our teachers, along with Ms. Rula, was involved, and had a chance to be able to look at a lot of different textbooks, not just for biology, but also for chemistry. And the beauty of that is the publishers will come, lots and lots of review copies, had a chance to be able to look at materials. We weren't able to select anything from that search. It was a budget issue at that time. So then the search continued again. It would be 15-16 school year. And out of that, we had selected two textbooks and had the representatives from both of these companies come and show us what they had. And our teachers decided, actually. Our teachers decided which learning system that they wanted. We actually voted on it twice, just to be sure, with a little bit of time in between. So they decided on the Pearson product, and it is quite a remarkable product. We're still, and I'll use this term, we're still unpacking it. It's an online program, actually aligned pretty beautifully with Massachusetts frameworks. And we've gone through a couple of trainings. We're still learning all the bells and whistles. Our students are still learning bells and whistles. But it seems to be working very, very well in relation to the new program that we have in terms of the Chromebooks. So I'm going to have you jump in. Go ahead.
Okay. My name is Lynn Cerullo. I've been teaching biology at the high school for 10 years now. And I was involved in both book committees. And the original book committee, we actually chose the same book the first time. And then I was involved in the second stage of this last, more recent committee, in which we also chose the same book. So I was able to see the presentations of several different book vendors. And we all kind of agreed on the same thing because for all the same reasons. So the reasons that we chose the Pearson books that we are currently using for all levels of biology are their superior visuals. So they have excellent diagrams and pictures and charts that we can use for teaching to get in the visual aspect of learning. There's an easy flow throughout each topic, and they build on each other, and they make a lot of real world connections. There are tremendous teacher resources for us to take advantage of now and in the future. We have the ability to download and edit and customize all of the lessons, and it includes the worksheets, the PowerPoints, tests, quizzes, any of those things involved with our lessons. We can actually take them and make them our own to use in the future. And we can also go back to the originals anytime we need to. The user-friendliness of the digital and audiobooks online is just very, very easy to use, and it was just so much easier to use than some of the other books. And I've spent many late nights unpacking this this book online just so that we could use all of our resources that are available to us. They also have a lot of excellent training resources for our teachers, and live in person, and also videos that are accessible online anytime that we have any questions to use them. So that's why we chose all of these. The Pearson was far superior to the other books that we had presented to us for all levels of biology.
Thank you, Mr. Hyatt, Mr. Rullo, thank you very much. Any questions for either one, Mrs. Dunn?
Actually, just a couple. Thank you. Excuse me. Is it just biology, or is it biology and chemistry?
No, right now it's just biology.
Okay. And I know in chemistry you do a lot with the labs. Do you still do laboratory work with the biology, and does this fit in with that?
Yes, they have a lot of our labs online that we can download and customize and print out, and they align with a lot of the labs that we were currently using, and they also have some upgrades that we can use now. They have some videos of different quick labs online as well, so and then some flipped classroom videos that we can use, have kids watch it at home on the Chromebooks, and then come in and we can talk about them in class.
I'm not trying to push the publisher at all, but that group has had labs for years. Every teacher in the United States have always held on to those lab books. They're the types of labs that we can actually do in a simple high school setting. Materials that are safe, easy to be able to pick up. You'd be surprised what you can do with a little hydrogen peroxide and an enzyme. Really good labs that give you data to be able to analyze. And that seems to be the push right now for us to be able to, for our students to be able to show that they can do science. That seems to be the trend in terms of assessment. So
more hands-on.
Right, a lot more. A lot more. So again, it's not just the chemistry. Chemistry program's been fabulous in terms of hands-on, but we're trying to step up even more now. And again, the target is, and I don't mind saying this in public, it is MCAS scores.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I understand, really.
But aside from the hands-on, the kids learning to do science and enjoying it, and that reinforcing what's taking place, I think it's going to add in terms of those assessments as well.
That's good. Thank you.
Any other questions, Mr. Roosevelt?
Thank you. Thank you very much. I know that you basically keyed in on online components, the other textbooks that come with the program. Did you get enough that each student has one, or are they just basically textbooks for the classroom, and then their homework is through online?
Students have a choice, actually. So we have, the first thing that we did, as literally unpacking, is class sets. The new Chromebooks went out. A lot of our students like reading on the Chromebooks. There's some that don't on the textbook. So that's
easy to do. Well, I know the Chromebooks are only in ninth grade, so the upperclassmen, if they're taking the biology course.
Okay, so now this is really biology one, which is a ninth grade.
So it's all for ninth grade.
So right now, this new adoption is just for ninth grade.
I do have some students that are not freshmen, and we make accommodations in the classroom. I have a class set of books, and everyone had an option of taking home a hardcover book if they chose to, and everyone has access to the online book as well.
Excellent. Now, how does this program articulate with the middle school program as far as the eighth grade and moving forward into the ninth grade?
The eighth grade is seem to be focusing on physical science. They seem to be gearing their order of exposing students to this eighth grade MCAS.
So
Middle school would have a life sciences program in the sixth grade.
Okay.
And
my son's currently in the sixth grade program here at the high school, and so they're currently learning about stuff that I teach in high school, cells and living things.
As we looked at these programs, we did the vertical articulation, and as we heard last time, it's an integrated program now, so it will be built upon more. They will have more knowledge and skill as they get here.
Okay.
And it's aligned beautifully with the standards.
Okay. Excellent. Now, are there consumables with this product?
With this product? They can get it online, or
we have printed versions as well.
You do, yeah. Okay. And it's for the life of the program.
Life of the program.
Yes.
And other upgrades are attached to the program?
Life of the program.
Okay.
So we were told that if it happens that another addition comes in relation to that contract that you have, that we would just receive a new textbook automatically. We don't see that happening, but if...
Right.
Yeah, we're tied into that.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Any other questions, Mrs. Carpenter?
Thank you. Thank you for being here. I appreciate your perspective and your information on the adoption of it. It's something that I always want to hear from the staff and from the people that know it the best, why you picked it, and it just definitely makes me feel better to hear the encouraging words that you said. I have a question, and I'm not sure if it's directed to you or to Ms. Mertek. Did we only adopt for ninth grade? Do we have anything from the 10th up, and we're only adopted biology, or what's the status on that?
We focused mainly on biology because it was the area that really needed some assistance.
Okay.
So right now we're pretty good. A&P anatomy and physiology we'll look at, but chemistry is good, and all the other sciences are good right now.
We're good right now on those.
George, would you break?
There's so many sciences that we teach, and that's something we're proud about. It is Bio 1 for ninth grade. That is MCAS, and then 10th grade, sophomore year, it's a chemistry. And during that time, there's a bit of a flexibility for a student to pick up something else, whether it's another science, so whether it's an astronomy class. Some kids like the forensics that we have. I mean, just a range of science classes that we teach, and wonderful instruction. I'm proud of our department.
The forensics is new. Was it this year or last year?
Last year.
Designed actually for a different level child, for a different student. We had this massive push in terms of the AP, which was successful, but we really needed to take care of the rest of our students. And so that's where, actually two courses, the forensics, and that was involved actually with the vocational school. They had that medical tech program. So they got excited about that. And then we also have an anatomy physiology two, a second year of that, and that's to support the med tech, so.
And the chemistry in 10th grade, in your opinion, where we're at curriculum-wise, we're okay right now with that? Does that need to be upgraded, or are we close?
We're gonna move into a point where we'll have to adopt another textbook. We're not quite there. 2 years ago, when we were looking, we didn't see anything that we really liked. We didn't see anything that was any better than what we're doing. But I think that as the computers are going into more and more students' hands, so each year the freshman class will be,
right,
will want to be able to make a switch soon. And again, the beauty of this Pearson program is its online capabilities. That's the strength of it. It is geared for that one-on-one initiative that you have. So chemistry will be there starting next year, and we're gonna want to think about it, so.
Okay, good to know, thank you.
That's it.
I appreciate it.
You're right there, yeah.
Thank you, Mrs. Cuthbert. Mr. Hoffman?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank the two of you and the rest of the science department, Ms. Martag, and everyone else that was involved in this committee that was fairly large in volume from elementary school up to the high school. And you spent a considerable amount of time, as Mr. Hyatt has described tonight, and looked at quite a number of products before you arrived at this Pearson program, not just the text, like you said, Mr. Hyatt. So I just want to thank you for the time and the commitment that you put in for that, for our students, the passion that you show, and the skills that you each have and you bring to your jobs every day. And in particular, Mr. Hyatt, I want to thank you. In recent years, in particular, I think since we met back at the high school maybe about 4 or 5 years ago, we started talking about vertical articulation and your involvement, your leadership in science classrooms throughout the district, not just at the high school level. So I just wanted to publicly thank you for that as well. Thank you.
Mrs. Dunn?
Thank you. Another question. Mr. Hyde, I know all the students have their Chromebooks and the teachers have the...
Just the freshmen.
Just the freshmen.
Just
okay.
The freshmen.
As far as technology in the classroom, do you have all the tools that you need, like the projectors to put something up on a screen or
anything? And the smart boards. The Wi-Fi system, that's what I call it, that's been upgraded, and I think there's more upgrades that are coming.
Yeah.
So at this point in time, everything's working well. We were initially concerned with that many students coming online, and the system's holding up. The system's doing well. We're just in the beginning with this. I didn't anticipate any problems. No, we're in pretty good shape.
Because I didn't know if you needed anything in the classroom itself to be able to utilize all those Chromebooks as well, or if the teacher has to do something that isn't going to come up on every Chromebook, just to make sure you have those
things.
Third
floor.
It's excellent.
Okay.
Well, I've always had excellent Wi-Fi. Yeah. I'm third floor.
So no, we're in good shape.
Good. And all the hoods working. Last time I was up there, we had a problem with the hood, so they
were. They are.
Okay, good. Did they fix the plumbing too?
We're getting there.
I have a list. It's all here. It's never going away. Coming up, I want to make sure you get the plumbing fixed.
We're getting there.
Because I know you need all those things to be able to do everything that the students require. Okay, I'm going up with a pad of paper and a list.
Thank you.
Well, again, Mr. Hyatt, Mrs. Rulo, thank you so much.
Thank you.
It's great to hear that this is working and that. We're helping assist in the implementation of the plan, so it's wonderful to hear.
If I may, Mr. Mayor, first of all, I'd like to thank you guys and all the teachers that worked on a very large committee for a very long time, at the coordination of our Assistant Superintendent, Kara Murtagh, as has been stated, they put in a lot of hours and a lot of hard work on behalf of the district. I'd also like to thank Chris Mitchell and under his direction, our techie boys, our tech department, who have lit up our schools and allowed our schools to expand in technology offerings by making sure that our infrastructure has been put to good use. I'd like to thank the school committee for allowing me to break the rules and have the program adopted before it came to you. Actually, it was supposed to come to you first, as you know, and as Brandy reminds me on a regular basis. I'd also like to suggest that without the mayor's help and backing through his capital budget, none of this would have been funded. So thank you so much for the coordinated effort of many, many people to make this happen.
Okay. Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next item will be, actually, there's no objection. We do have Deb Murphy here, does a terrific job for us. He's going to be giving us an update on homelessness regulations. If there's no objection, I'd like to go out of order to Deb Murphy. Great. Deb, come on up.
Through the back.
Deb Murphy and I have been working closely on this, and Deb is going to tell you and explain to you what happened, what the regulations last year, and now all the changes this year, as of October 1 and December 1.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I know you all know me as the kindergarten coordinator, but you probably don't, some of you may not realize that I've been the homeless liaison for the past 4 years as well. As Ms. Murtaugh said, I've been asked by the superintendent and the assistant superintendent to come and give you a very brief update and overview on the changes that have happened and that we have been working on since last March. So what happened was last December 2015, the McKinney-Vento Act, which is the federal act for homelessness, was reauthorized under ESSA, which is Every Student Succeeds Act, which replaced No Child Left Behind. The changes did not go into effect until October 1st, 2016, and then there's another change that's happening December 10th, 2016. So I want to, because I want to get the wording right, I want to read you just one statement under the new McKinney-Vento law that is part of the definition. And it says, the McKinney-Vento Act ensures homeless children and youth have equal access to the same free and appropriate public education, including public preschool education, as provided other children and youth. So there are several changes that could and will financially impact not only our districts, but all of the districts. So as Ms. Murtaugh explained, the three major ones, I'm first going to tell you what it was like under the old McKinney-Vento Act and what it is now so that you can see the comparison. Prior to the reauthorization, if we had a homeless child that got promoted to a grade that required them to go to another building, so for us that's fifth grade to Higgins and eighth grade to the high school, that child going into the new grade no longer had a school of origin, which meant under McKinney-Vento, we were not obligated to then transport them when they started at the Higgins and then when they started at the high school. And several districts use that, and what we used to do here in Peabody is we would tell the parents, the fifth grade parents and the eighth grade parents at the end of the year, that this is the law. If they wanted to continue at the Higgins or the high school, they could apply for school choice. If it was approved, that was fine, they could attend, but then they would have to transport the child themselves. As of October 1st of this year, the law now states that the receiving school, or as it's also referred to in the McKinney-Vento law, the feeder school, is still considered the school of origin. So we now will continue to transport that child when they get promoted to Higgins or when they get promoted to the high school, which means that we will be paying to transport them for a longer amount of time. The second change when, under the old McKinney-Mento, when a homeless child became permanently housed during the school year. Now, this is a child, a Peabody child, say, that became homeless and was placed outside of the city for whatever reason. We would set up transportation and transport them back to Peabody. Under the old law, when that family became permanently housed during the school year, we would no longer be obligated to transport them. Under the law, they could continue to finish out the school year here in Peabody without applying for school choice, because this would still be under McKinney-Mento, but the parent or the guardian would have to transport them at that point. The new change is, when a family becomes permanently housed during the school year, it is the responsibility of the district to continue to transport that child from outside the city back to Peabody until the last day of school. So again, we are going to be required to transport them for a longer amount of time. The third point is, under the old McKinney-Vento Act, preschool children were not included in McKinney-Vento at all. Under the new act, as you heard me read in that one sentence, preschool children are afforded the same services under McKinney-Vento as all of the grades 12 to K McKinney-Vento children. It also states that if we are using federal money to run a preschool, which we are, our Title I preschool housed at the Welch, we must reserve at least one slot, leave it open for any parent that may become homeless during the school year, has a preschool child, and would like that preschool child to attend a preschool. It doesn't apply to PASOS, because PASOS isn't using federal money to run their program. It would apply to the integrated preschool under some circumstances. And what you have to understand, and Dr. Levine and Assistant Superintendent Murtagh we have talked about this, everything that has to do with McKinney-Vento and our students becoming homeless is a constant moving target with lots and lots of moving pieces that we have to keep track of and keep our eyes on. So every case is looked at individually. And I feel that I'm lucky here in Peabody, because Peabody's always used, it's not only myself as the liaison, our transportation director and our coordinator of our attendance office work very closely with me. So we have three sets of eyes on all of this at all times, which, let me tell you, really, really helps. Now, the fourth thing is, under the old law, part of the definition for being eligible for McKinney-Vento services was any child awaiting foster care. Beginning December 10th, that definition is coming out of the McKinney-Vento law and going into Title I Part A. And I want to read you this, because this is the wording that has come down. The reauthorization document continues on by stating that students in foster care will still be entitled to McKinney-Vento-like protections. Students in foster care have a right to remain in their school of origin. However, Title I Part A states, LEAs, which is us, are not required to provide school of origin transportation if there are additional costs, unless they are reimbursed by the child welfare agency or they agree to provide it. It also goes on to state in another way, LEAs will provide transportation to the school of origin if they are reimbursed by the child welfare agency, they agree to pay for the costs, or they cost share between the LEA and the child welfare agency. We have gotten no guidance or advisories from the Office of Homeless Education from out of DESE yet on this. What we have gotten is very murky and fuzzy. And this change starts December 10th. What I have been told from DESE is, we can't require you to transport children that go into state custody back to Peabody. However, we expect you to figure out how to do that. Now, in the very near future, superintendent, assistant superintendent, myself, all of you. We are going to have to revise our McKinney-Vento policy to reflect all these changes. We are also going to have to develop a policy pertaining to the foster care children. My recommendation to superintendent and assistant superintendent obviously was, don't do anything yet until DESC gets finalized on the wording and the content of all of this. I have been checking all the big school districts, Lynn, Lowell, Lawrence, Boston, Springfield. They all still have the old McKinney-Vento policy posted on their websites, as do we. Once we develop those policies, they have to be on the website. They also have to be included in the student handbooks. So, I've given you a ton of information. I have been dealing with this since last March doing trainings. So my head has stopped spinning. I'm sure yours is spinning like mine has been. I think we all need to be aware of that the costs are going to impact the district. And it's mandated. It's the federal law.
Well, that was a great summary, Ms. Murphy. Thank you. Covered a lot of ground there, educated us quite a bit. Before I go to questions, Dr. Levine.
Just through the chair, I expect that somewhere between $50,000 and $100,000 will be the impact for us that we don't have budgeted. And I do want to make it clear that none of these mandates came with any increase in funds, either in Title I or in any other area.
Do they ever?
No. So, however, the bottom line is, and you won't be surprised when I say this, these kids have enough confusion in their lives, and we're going to make sure they have a place to go to school.
Any questions for Mrs. Murphy? Mr. Rosenbaum?
Yeah, just logistically, if a student is now placed outside of the city and another student placed in a different district, I mean, how can you even provide transportation when you're talking about a bunch of different communities coming back to our district? How does that happen logistically in our system?
Okay, our transportation director puts each child's case out to bid, and she coordinates, she does an unbelievable job of coordinating with vendors, approved contracted vendors. Mm-hmm. They may be going to a certain place, say for example, if a child's in a group home, that vendor may be going to that group home picking up six students. Three of them are going to Salem, two are going to Beverly, and one's coming to Peabody. Mm-hmm. So she does all of that.
No. I'm sorry, through the chair. Is there boundaries? And what I mean by that, if a student and their family for some reason still wants to finish their education in Peabody but get relocated, I don't know, to Groton, mm-hmm. We're still, there is no boundary as far as how far away that child is placed to come back to the district.
So if I could through the chair, there isn't a boundary.
Okay.
And we are still responsible for figuring that out.
Okay.
In many cases, parents want to finish the year.
Absolutely.
But will then, if they're that far away, will choose to send their children to school closer. But at least for a period of time, we're still responsible.
Okay. And last, this will be more of a statement, and through the chair to Dr. Levine, I couldn't agree with you more. Ultimately, educating the child is number one. But I just, and this is just one small example of the state and the federal government making mandates, making half murky mandates as you stated so eloquently, but expecting us to kind of pick up the slack and move from that, take the hit on our budget to make sure that these children, and like you said, Dr. Levine, deserve the education that they do. But where the rubber meets the road, and there is no funding source, there's really no expectation from the state or the federal government to even help in these matters, and I think that's appalling. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rosenbaum. Mrs. Dunn and Mr. Miko?
This is just a question. I don't know if this has changed the law. At one point, for transportation of homeless children, there was something where the, like, the two school systems that were involved, for example, the place where the child was housed and the place where they were being educated, had to split the cost. So does this change that at all?
No, everything is still cost-shared. The district where the family is housed pays half, and the district that where the school of origin is pays half.
Okay. And has that worked? Do you deal with the school districts, or does it go through the state? I'm assuming if you go through the school districts, you get reimbursed, but if you have to go through the state, that money is going to go somewhere else.
Through the chair. No, that comes to us.
Yes.
We sometimes we are the people that are sending the money, mm-hmm. and sometimes we're the people receiving it.
Okay.
But it's between the districts.
Thank you. Mr. Miko.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Through the chair, Ms. Murphy, thank you for being here. That was excellent. Obviously, we have to follow the new laws. Maybe this is for Dr. Levine and Mrs. Manager. Maybe we can keep a separate line item on how it was a year ago to the new year, just so we know what the difference in funding is. That way, if there's any way we could recoup that through the government, we can, just so we can just know what we were paying 2 years ago, so to speak, and this year, just so we have a better idea. And I think you said it might be somewhere from 50 to 100,000.
Through the chair. We'll have that in the budget, and you'll be able to see it, okay. What we spent this year and what we project. Actually, Jared's done a terrific job in giving you a five-year comparison. So we may be able to provide that for you as well.
That's great. Thank you.
Mr. Lincoln.
Through the chair, how many homeless children do we have that this impacts currently and roughly last year?
So it's around the same as last year. Right now we have around 84, unless that number's changed. Is that about right?
That's about right.
And 71 a bust. So it's 90%.
Ms. Governor.
Thank you. Through the chair, I'm not sure who can answer this. Isn't there a law that states that a child can't be on a bus for more than 45 minutes to an hour?
There is. Pre-K and K is now 45 minutes, and grades 1 through 12 is an hour. So when, sometimes, as Dr. Levine said, it is ultimately, you know, our responsibility, if it's a Peabody student, to try to get that child back here. So what happens is, if a child is placed, like Mr. Rosenthal said, in Groton, right? I get on MapQuest and I type in the address of where the child is housed to whatever school the child, we're dropping that child off to. And we know that pickup time coming to school and going home is usually the high traffic times anyways. So what happens is, then we print that out and MapQuest will tell you moderate traffic, you know that. We can refuse to say, we will say to the parent, look, this child is going to be on this vehicle for an hour and a half, an hour and 45 minutes. This is not in the best interest of the child. If we do that, we then have to fill out a dispute of setting up transportation, which the parent gets a copy. They also have a form to fill out. Both of those forms then go to DESE, and DESE makes the final recommendation. However, while this is all going on, we have to set up transportation from Groton to Peabody so that the child continues to stay in school.
Sure, no, I understand that. In regards to the new law in the preschool, so we need to keep a slot open. Is it a percentage of slots based on how many we have that we have to keep open, or just one, no matter how many?
No, it's just one, because in our Title I preschool, the max we take is 40 children, so they are just recommending that we have at least one slot available.
Okay, and on the McCarthy, you said that's going to kind of vary.
Well, what's going to vary is, one, if the child is on an IEP, then that child definitely is going to get, you know, bus back and forth. If it's a model child that's paying tuition, in actuality, we tend to call the office at DESE for everyone. We've only had, I will tell you, in the 4 years I've been doing this, we've only had two children at the McCarthy that this has happened to. And they kind of rule, the Department of Ed usually rules for us. We give them the circumstances, what's happening. I think, and in all honesty, Mrs. Carpenter, one of them, like Mr. Rosner, I mean, this child was housed, like, without traffic, 2 hours away, and we were like, we can't bus this three-year-old child back and forth to Peabody. That's, you know.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. You've certainly enlightened us.
Okay.
Regarding regulations.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deb.
Thank you.
All right, we'll now go back to the original format of the agenda. So looking for approval of minutes.
Motion to approve minutes from October 25th, 2016, the Middle School Committee meeting.
Second. Heard the motion by Mr. Hockman, seconded by Mr. Amico. Roll call vote.
Mr. Hockman?
Yes.
Mr. Rosner? Mrs. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dunn?
Yes, I'm so disappointed all the funny comments were in there. Some of our best material was on the cutting room floor for those minutes of that last meeting.
Mr. Olivia?
Yes.
Mr. Amico?
Yes.
Thank you. Approval of bills?
Thank you.
I'd like to make a motion to approve warrant A, number 3241, dated November 9th, in the amount of $861,978.05, subject to audit.
Second.
You heard the motion by Mrs. Carpenter, seconded by Mr. Hockman. Roll call vote.
Mr. Hockman?
Yes.
Mrs. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Olivia?
Yes.
Mr. Amico?
Yes.
Thank you. I'd like to make a motion to approve warrant B, number 3242, in the amount of $48,692.96, dated November 9th, subject to audit.
Second.
You heard the motion by Mrs. Carpenter, seconded by Mr. Hockman. Roll call vote.
Mr. Hockman?
Yes.
Mrs. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Olivia?
Yes.
Mr. Amico?
Yes.
Thank you. Moving on to continued business, the MSBA Higgins project. Ms. Dunn.
Thank you, Ms. Osborne. The monthly MSBA School Building Committee meeting will take place here in the Higgins Library tomorrow afternoon at 4 p.m. It's just our regular scheduled meeting, and I know that as people look, you can see the changes being made over on phase two, and the through road is really very, very close to being paved, which is going to be a big accomplishment. It will help a lot with the traffic, but just so people understand, the traffic pattern here at the school is going to stay the same for the rest of the year. And the drainage and all of the preparations for the fields, the new parking areas, that's what's going on now on phase two. So we'll get an update tomorrow. We will be getting more updates on the punch list. There are a lot of things being tended to here in the building. Because of the new systems, you know, they're really trying to put them through their paces to make sure that they're all right up to snuff and that they're all in working order before they're accepted. So things get better every day. Things here in the building where there might be a light switch that they have a problem with, or you know, a locker or something like that, those are all being taken care of. They're being noted, and they're going through this list that has thousands and thousands of details on it.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Four kids only before and after school program. Dr. Levine.
Through the chair, before the bell program began this week, began on Monday successfully in all the schools. They are staffed and up and running, and everything seems to be going very well. I think Mrs. Murtagh saw one of the programs that are up and running this morning and was very pleased. So we're very pleased with that. And the after-school program continues to be moving along quite well as well, so that's done.
Before I go to Mr. Amico, I noticed that we had a flyer in our packet. Did that go out to the families via backpack?
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Mr. Amico.
Through the chair, Dr. Levine, and actually the whole committee, I just want to thank Dr. Levine, your staff, Ms. Dunn, and the parents who came forward. It was truly democracy in action. You know, we came up with an idea, there was a need for it, the communication was amazing, and we had a survey, and I just think that everyone was involved, just did a great job, and I just want to commend you guys for doing a great job.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rico.
Thank you.
do you think we could continue to have updates? I know enrollment right now is currently low, but we sent out the flyer. Can you just have an update of how that enrollment is kind of progressing?
Sure, I'll give you a monthly update.
That'd be great, thank you. Public participation. Mic is open if anybody chooses to come forward.
Jared, you want to say something, buddy?
No, I'm kidding. You know, you'll say something.
There were three of them now.
That's right. All right, seeing none, we'll move on to the superintendent's report. Dr. Levine.
Thank you very much. I'm going to turn it over to Assistant Superintendent Murtagh for an MCAS and a TSAC update.
MCAS, we are doing it online, as we all know. And we started the process with the teachers during professional development, which Mr. Hoffman will give an update for our meeting last night. However, we did Chromebook training and we gave teachers, we made a little cheat sheet, the tech department made a little cheat sheet, and we started talking about the universal features versus the designated features. The universal features are for all students, what they need on the MCAS that they can have for a feature on their Chromebook, and the designated features are for students who need different accommodations on 504s and IEPs. So that process has started, so I will continue to update you on those, and teachers will continue to get professional development on that. And also, as we continue to use our Chromebooks, students will learn each day in the classroom. So I will continue to update you on that.
Great, thank you very much. Any questions?
Through the chair. Okay.
Ms. Murtagh, or Dr. Levine, I know when we talked about moving MCAS to online, one of the questions I had was whether parents can opt out, considering it's really not MCAS, it's PARC. So did we get a response back from that question?
To the chair and the committee, there is no opt out. If people do opt out, if there are enough people that opt out, the school will suffer. Okay. So there is no opt out.
Fair enough. Thank you.
You're welcome. I would ask the committee for an approval of the field trip by DECA to Washington, D.C.
Motion to follow the superintendent's recommendation.
Thank you.
Second.
You heard the motion by Mrs. Carpenter, seconded by Mr. Olympio. Roll call.
Mr. Hawkins?
Abstain.
Mrs. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Olympio?
Yes.
Mr. Nico?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I will turn this back over to Ms. Murtagh for discussion, quick discussion of the professional development schedule.
I'm just going to jump back to DSAC quick, because Jared's going to do that after. DSAC is the District and School Assistance Center, and we've been working with them from the Department of Education. And they help level three schools, and they have helped tremendously with the West, Brown, Higgins, and now they are focused at the high school, and Eric and his team have done an unbelievable job. And we're going to be, we're creating a data team there at the high school, and also instructional rounds, which teachers go around to see best practices in each other's classrooms, but in different contents. So basically, they're learning, it's a professional learning community. And this is all happening, and they're doing a tremendous job. So our schools that were in level three are out, so we're boosting our high school now at this point with the support of DSAC. So I just wanted to share that with you.
And through the chair, I just want to say that the people from the state on DSAC are high quality people. These are highly skilled individuals that really do have an impact on us. So we're very pleased with that. Thank you. Did you want to say anything about professional development?
When Jared does his committee report, we'll jump in.
Great.
Ms. Dunn.
This was a question. The DSAC is all connected with MCAS, isn't it? To the chair, anybody.
Yes. They take a look at those scores and they really drill down those scores, and that's how we figure out. We look at that data together as a team and figure out the areas that we need to improve upon and the areas that we're really strong in. And they have visual aids to support us in that.
The reason I ask the question is because I know, you know, so much in the system is
it is revolving around MCAS and the scores and everything. But one of the things that it is so frustrating because, of course, everything is always constantly ranked. There's always, some quote-unquote contest where the greatest high schools in the state or in the country, and there's all these rankings by U.S. News Report and USA Today and whoever. And I just wondered, have we, or could we, look at the high school and find out what exactly do other schools do that we don't, that keep us from getting into those higher echelon, standings? And this is PB Pride. I want a school to be number one. But it isn't just with the MCAS. And I honestly feel we don't toot our own horn enough about the good things at that high school. If you ever talk to people who didn't go there or they're just moving in, and you tell them about the high school, they're shocked. They are absolutely amazed to hear about the courses that we offer, about the standing with the AP program, even the facilities. They are really, really floored because they're going by some biases that they've heard, or perhaps they don't know anything about the school. And I was just wondering if we could start to really work on the image. Honestly, everything in life now is marketing. And we constantly see MCAS scores, but it ignores all the other really good work that's going on up there and all the opportunities that our students have. And it's frustrating when you read about other schools, because I'll be honest, I sit there like, we do that. They don't do that when we do this. It's very, very frustrating, and I think it's something that a lot of other people probably feel that as well. And I'd like to ask if we could look into that. I don't know how DSAC looks at programs. I know they're looking through an MCAS filter. But there's got to be some type of a matrix that we could put together ourselves to say, look at what we do, look at this, and then get that word out. A lot of schools are recruiting right now. I've seen open houses up at the Essex Tech and a lot of the private high schools. And I know this is the time of year when people are looking in the middle school years, determining when their kids are going to go to the high school. And I'll be honest, I want us to compete. I want people to want to go there. I want people to understand it's a really good school and that their students are going to get a great education. And I think we need to do something really kind of structured now.
Through the chair. So academically, DSAC helps us in that way because they do look at other schools, high performing, and other schools as well. And they will be able to help us understand what other strategies are used throughout the state for schools that are in the 1-2 range and help us move into that range. Sometimes it is just strategies. It's just a different way of teaching the same thing. As far as image is concerned, you're absolutely right. We don't toot our horn enough, but I will say, and I've said it many times, the best thing about our school system, and there are a lot of great things to say about our school system, including our staff, but the best thing about our school system is our kids. And everywhere they go, whether it be through sports or extracurricular activities, or just around the streets of Peabody, they represent the Peabody Public Schools extremely well. So very proud of our kids, very proud of what we accomplished. And I'm really proud of the high school, and they work very hard up there. And I think that we're going to start to see a coordinated plan with DSAC. I will have a couple of recommendations to you on the budget, if we have any money. And
where's John Cherko?
I think that working together with the high school administration and faculty, DSAC, and some recommendations that we'll have for next year, I think we'll start to see movement.
Any other comments, Mr. Rosenberg?
Thank you. Through the chair to Ms. Martek. I know you said that teachers are going to start to shadow other, not even necessarily the same content matter that they teach. And I like that. It kind of keeps the teachers well-rounded. Are they doing that in their off periods?
Yes, we're looking at the plans now to see what we can do, okay, because we can't cover substitutes for so many, but it will be structured. It would be a plan.
Perfect.
In place.
Thank you.
Sorry, I'm not used to. Ms. Dunn, I just want to let you know, talking about the recruiting piece, the eighth graders are visiting the high school this week.
Oh, good.
They were there today and yesterday, and they're going tomorrow.
Great.
So,
and they put in a parent component to, remember they did the YPB high?
He's doing that. I believe he scheduled that for next week as well.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, one more question, please.
On that note, when the eighth graders come up, do they meet with specific students? They go into classrooms, or how does that operate? Or is it more like facility and see the building type of thing?
See the building, go into some classrooms.
Okay.
And we're also pushing our vocational programs as well. So they're seeing everything.
I'm just, so is today the first day and there's multiple times that they're coming?
Yesterday, today, and I believe tomorrow.
I just wonder if part of their tour, if maybe some senior leadership kids always do better with kids.
They do. They're taking them on the tour.
Okay.
Kids are.
But now, do they set up a meeting with them too to say all the great things and the great experiences that they necessarily had over the 4 years that they were there?
I will get you the agenda of how it works.
Yeah, that'd be great. I'd appreciate that.
Sure.
Does Dr. Levine hip hop in these sessions?
He's going tomorrow.
Nope, that would keep many kids out.
He's going tomorrow.
They would be going other places.
Platform shoes would look good.
He has them.
Thank you.
He has them.
Mr. Amico, through the chair. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The chair, Dr. Levine, and Mr. Brightside again, and follows up on what Ms. Dunn was saying. It isn't fair that a level three high school, Peabody High School is a level three high school, because it doesn't feel like it. You know, we hear of all the great things, you know, when we have students here, you know, participating here or in sports or in dance or drama or any extracurricular activities. It just doesn't feel like a level three score, and it's in school, and it's just too bad that just, the state's looking at their scores only, and they're not looking at the whole child. And we've made a commitment here, and we have for a long time, to focus on educating the whole child. And I think that's just one of those things that, you know, we have to get over with. And, you know, just know that there's a lot of pride up there, and it, the teachers and students are just doing a great job. And I just, again, I want to applaud that staff up there, because I know they are. So, and just one more point. On the instructional rounds, is that through Harvard University, or?
It is. That's where Mr. Bishop from DSAC got the idea. It's
okay,
all
great.
The
it's Thank great. You. It's a great program.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Miko.
Thank you.
Okay. Dr. Levine, turn it back to you.
Thank you. Just the professional development schedule was there for your perusal. I don't think we have to refer to it.
Just a comment. Thank you for giving us that. That was amazing. That was really a great schedule. So good work, Ms. Brinkman.
And thank you for that, Ms. Dunn. And lastly, the monthly hiring status report. There's really nothing to talk about there, but I did want to tell you that we're still having a great deal of trouble filling the Spanish classes at the high school. We have two teachers who are out on maternity leave, and one is coming back in January, one's coming back, I think, in December. But we've had a whale of a time providing a quality certified Spanish teacher to replace those people the first half of the year. And we continue to have that problem. So short of me flying to Madrid, my expectation is that we will find nobody right now. And we're doing the best that we can. We're going to contract with Edgenuity, and they were ready to provide for us, but we can't schedule it. It's just impossible to schedule it. And service these kids. So I apologize for that. I wish there were people available. It wouldn't matter to us at what end of the scale they were, but we just can't find them. We continue to look. I wanted to say one more thing. We did have a tragic event in this city with the death of Ella O'Donnell. And as with other tragedies that we've suffered in Peabody, the Peabody community has showed what it's made of by everybody from every walk of life stepping forward in a compassionate, kind, and dignified manner to help the family to help Sydney, the oldest sister, and to help the staff, quite frankly, get through this very, very difficult time. I'm very, very proud of, and I cannot thank enough, the entire community, and I wanted to focus on just a few people, if I might. Kara Murtagh worked tirelessly with Monique to develop a schedule so that we had people, counselors from around the city who worked off their shifts and off their schools to come into the South to be available throughout the last few weeks. That schedule worked well. People truly appreciated that. And I wanted to thank the counselors, all of our counselors, guidance counselors and SACs, for being willing to share their expertise and their compassion with those who needed it, regardless of how intrusive it might have been to their own schedules. I wanted to thank all the parents from the South community particularly, who have been a rock for this family. I wanted to thank Julie Butt. Julie is a paraprofessional who got very, very close to Eller and was Ella's rock in school. They became very friendly. She became very friendly with the family and with Ella herself. And I cannot tell you how much she has done in that capacity as a confidant and a compassionate ear for Ella as she went through her difficult time. With tragedy comes light, and the light that came out of this was once again a reminder of how great this community is and how terrific our people are. The strength of this community is its people, and once again, they shone through during this terrible time. Thank you.
Well, that was very well said, Malcolm. Thank you. We do have a couple of written communications. Number one, letter from the DESE regarding approval of Chapter 74 Medical Assisting Program at Peabody High School. And number two, letter to DESE Commissioner Mitchell Chester regarding the waiver for the South School Day Off.
So through the mayor, I need a vote to submit this letter officially to the commissioner. I have talked with him on the phone. I did explain the circumstances. He was extremely sympathetic and compassionate. I asked a number of questions. For those of you that don't know Commissioner Chester, he very rarely, if ever, gives waivers for the 180 days. I feel that we should request the waiver. I think we have a legitimate reason to do so. If he does not grant the waiver, and he may not, and that will be okay, we'll simply add this day to the end of the school year and get it done that way. Either way, I think that submitting the letter is the right thing to do, and I would ask for a vote to allow me to do that.
Motion to follow the recommendation of the superintendent.
Second.
And you heard the motion by Mr. Rousignol, seconded by Mrs. Dunn. Roll call vote on the motion. Mr. Meikle?
Not so much on the motion, but with us doing 180 and 990 hours, that might be something to think about in the future, and I know it's a labor issue to maybe go on an extra day. Where a couple of years ago we had extra snow days and teachers and students had a report on a Monday, I believe, after a long weekend. And it just would give us some flexibility in the future. If we had a situation like this, we wouldn't even have to apply for a waiver. We could come together as a school committee and make that decision. So it might be something to think about in the future. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Meikle. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Hockman?
Yes.
Mr. Rosenbaum?
Yes.
Mrs. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Olympia?
Yes.
Mr. Meikle?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Subcommittee reports, education. Mr. Hartman?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Ms. Murtagh has alluded to a few times. The Education Subcommittee had an opportunity to meet last night here at the Higgins, and we did go over the professional development schedule that is in our packets. I wanted to, before I get into it, thank Ms. Murtagh. All of the administrators, including principals, facilitators, including Mr. Haas, who's with us on a regular basis, for the professional development that did take place on Tuesday, November 8th, Election Day. I would also point out that this was, I believe, the first time that Unit C, our paraprofessionals, actually operated under the contract that I'm not sure that we've ratified yet, but the full-time paraprofessionals received professional development for 6 hours on November 8th, which was a change from a past practice. contractually agreed upon, but again, I don't think it's ratified yet, so I want to thank them for participating in the professional development in the manner that they did. And I think part-time paraprofessionals had a three-hour professional development session in various settings. Professional development that we talked about yesterday, I don't want to go through it all because it's here for us to see, but one of the more interesting points that Mr. Murtagh brought to our attention was keyboarding with Chromebooks. And since we are going to be participating in MCAS 2.0 online, this allowed for our staff to learn how to manipulate Chromebooks in ways that our students would better be able to utilize the Chromebooks for taking the MCAS exam, as well as other opportunities that they would, that our students will have in the future using the Chromebooks that we've leased for them and will continue to do so through the technology plan. So those are just some of the highlights I wanted to bring up with regard to professional development. And from what I understand, it went very nicely and smoothly. I know there were some concerns with some traffic issues, particularly in South Peabody. I believe that that all went well without any issues. If I can, through the chair, ask Ms. Murtagh to provide us with an update with regard to the planetarium and how that's moving along.
We have a beautiful planetarium at the high school, and I did have a conversation with Mr. Murphy, Howard Murphy, who it's his passion. So Dr. Levine, myself, and Mr. Buckley, in the near future, are going to have a meeting with him to try to figure out how we can have our students visit the planetarium. So I will continue to update you on that as we meet with Mr. Murphy and Mr. Buckley.
And if I, Dr. Levine?
Through the chair, just to prepare you, if we really want the planetarium to be a centerpiece for kids K through 12, particularly K through 8, we're going to have to do something with his schedule in order to modify it so that he has the time to do what he needs to do.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Levine. That is something that came up in conversation last night. He is one person and he has a full schedule as it is, and we did make an investment greatly through his efforts in fundraising to upgrade that planetarium so that it's functional again. And I know that Ms. Dunn has a long history of that planetarium and was passionate about revitalizing it, and we have. And during the conversation last night, we did talk about bringing or allowing for middle school students in addition to elementary school students to have field trips over to the planetarium, and might give them a good opportunity to view our high school and some of the great things that are going on there. So thank you, Ms. Murtagh, for facilitating that, and if you can perhaps report back to us after you meet with the administration and staff of the high school, that would be fantastic. If I can continue, there was also a special education, not a subcommittee meeting last night, but the CPAC met with the basic rights workshop that is statutorily mandated to be held in each school district on an annual basis, free of charge, and it was held last night. I did attend that with our friend Mark, who unfortunately isn't with us tonight. He joined us last night thinking that the school committee meeting was taking place, but he did join me in attending the CPAC meeting, and it was a wonderful presentation as far as rights that are afforded to parents and students who have special needs, whether they be emotional or learning disabilities or the wide range of services that we should and do offer students with who require special or additional services. So I just want to report that that did take place last night. It was fairly well attended. I want to say that there were about 15 people in attendance, and I want to congratulate and thank the CPAC co-chairs for putting that on, and they did it in a very, very nice manner. And lastly, I know a few years ago, I think Mr. Rosenthal, we talked about updating our strategic plan. We did talk about this last night in the regular, curriculum and instruction or education subcommittee meeting, and I'd like to make a motion to ask, I don't know if it's Mr. Stanton or Ms. Murtagh, one of them to provide us with some information in the future about, within a meeting or two, of the cost of the facilitator for developing or furthering our strategic plan.
Second.
You've heard the motion by Mr. Hockman, seconded by Mr. Rosignol. All in favor? Thank you.
Through the chair.
Mm-hmm.
On the motion, on that subject. I would probably come back to you and recommend that we put out a request for bids, request for proposals for that. There are at least three or four major companies that do that on a regular basis. You're familiar with a couple of them. Let them bid, and then it will be up to you to decide the product versus the price and what you guys want to do. My recollection is that a good quality, full strategic plan, somewhere in the $20,000 to $25,000 range.
Mr. Mayor, if I may amend my motion to adopt the recommendation of the superintendent.
Second.
Okay. Heard the motion by Mr. Hockman, seconded by Mr. Rosignol. All in favor? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Hockman.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Finance, Mrs. Carpenter.
Thank you. I just wanted to go back on the planetarium. I had been approached by several just general public that wanted to come in and see it. So that's something that I was asked to look into, maybe on the weekends, maybe once a month. We could open it up, maybe, you know, field trip from the Pterygian Center, something like that. You know, most of us here had an opportunity to go in and see the new updated planetarium a year or two ago. And I had some people reach out. So if you could look into that as well, that would be great.
Actually, through the chair, we could make that part of a proposal that we come back to you with, to make that part of a job description if he's willing to do that. I think that's a great way to introduce the community to some of the things that we have out there.
And back to the Finance Subcommittee. We are in active negotiations still with AFSCME, and just a point of information, we did ratify with Unit C, but we did have some side language in the subcommittee that we have to meet on and just finalize it. And one of those side subcommittees that we had, Ms. Murtagh took care of that wonderful professional development that you spoke about that the Paras were part of this time, so I want to thank you for that. So we do have to finalize that. And that's all I have, and I have nothing for the Safety Committee at this time.
Thank you, Mrs. Godwin. Yeah. Athletics and Wellness, Mr. Rosignol.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had an athletic subcommittee meeting on November 1st. In attendance was Mr. Hockman, myself, Mr. Sheridan, and Dr. Levine. Topics that we discussed were money brought into the district by athletic fees that we currently charge. And he's going to come back with a finite number. Other topics that we have discussed were the evaluation process, the evaluation tool that Mr. Sheridan uses for his coaches. He's going to come back with a couple of recommendations that we have, and then we'll move that on to quality and standards once it's more ratified in athletics. Another topic that we had discussed was gate receipts and the price for athletic events, whether it's the referees, the scorers table, the ticket takers, and a breakdown of how much each sport costs versus what we take in. And the goal, at least in my mind, is to see if we can, at the very least, get rid of the gate fee, potentially maybe lower the athletic fee and come to some sort of understanding of where the money goes, how it's taken in, how much we take in, and how much it actually costs for each sport. Our next meeting is going to be January 17th. It'll be at the high school in the library. And I thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Rosignol. Quality and standards, Mrs. Dunn?
Nothing to report
at the moment. Liaison to City Council and advisory boards, Mrs. Dunn?
We have the parent advisory board meeting Monday at 7 at the Carroll School cafeteria.
Okay. Thank you very much. Building and grounds, we did have a building and grounds meeting prior to this meeting tonight, and I will give a report at the next meeting. A new business, any new business? I did want to mention, I want to propose and I wanted to see if the members were comfortable. I have received a number of calls from residents of the city looking to see if we were going to have one more open house for the Higgins, the new Higgins. And I thought it might be opportunity before the winter to maybe try to have an afternoon or something that's convenient that we could offer one more open house. Certainly, this continues to be great interest and great enthusiasm about the new school. And some people were not able to make it at the original open house we had a few weeks back. So if it's okay with the committee, I'd like to talk with Dr. Levine, Assistant Superintendent Murtagh, Mr. Busey, and arrange a time and a date for that. Mr. Hartman?
On a different subject, if anyone wants to talk about that.
On that, Mrs. Dunn and Mr. Miko?
It's just to help out. Tell anybody who wants to see the building to come to the Higgins PTO Craft Fair. Here on Saturday, the 3rd.
Perfect.
And then they can at least see part of the building and enjoy all kinds of wonderful gifts and things for the holidays and get some sneak peeks in some areas of the building.
I like how you think, Mrs. Dunn.
Oh, yeah. PTO all the way.
Mr. Miko?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, for suggesting that. Also, I'd like to see if we could probably include the Senior Center and Brooksview Village and see if we can get a couple of vans over here because the seniors have taxes have been raised and we should show them what they're getting in such a beautiful building. I think they'd really appreciate that invitation.
Great. So, I will do that, sir. Good, thank you. Now, what are you, Mr. Hartman?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to thank Dr. Levine, Ms. Groby, Eileen Bresnahan, and everyone else that worked on a very, very sensitive issue that required a tremendous amount of urgency that came up this morning that has already been resolved and is resolved by noon. I just want to thank you all for the hard work and the efforts that you made to make a young man's life a lot more palatable.
Good. Thank you, Mr. Hartman. Mr. Rosignol?
Just a shameless plug. At the high school this weekend is the fall play.
Yes.
That wasn't too shameless.
Yeah, no,
I was trying to look it up really quickly what the name of it is.
Yeah, the dinner table.
Yeah something like that.
A piece of it. It was terrific. Great.
Motion to adjourn.
Items handled in the regular course of business for the next agenda. Thank you for a good meeting.